Pastor, you can count it.
Good morning, New Life Church. If you're in the sanctuary, please stand up and sing along with us. If you're in the foyer, come on in and let's sing some songs.
God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. Joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place. He won't be quiet, he shout out your praise.
We sing to the God who hears, we sing to the God who saves, we sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross, he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away.
There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet, we shout out your praise.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. Forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord.
There's joy in the house of the Lord today.
And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Once again, there's joy in here this morning. Please turn around and say good morning to someone and show something happy.
Church. I just want to, as you remain standing, invite you into a time of prayer together. And I just want to give you an opportunity, a moment here, just to bring to God what's on your heart. Maybe some praise, an expression of gratitude to Him for who He is and what He's done. Maybe you come in here this morning carrying some burden, some great need that you want to give to God and lay at His feet. Something you need from Him. Maybe there's just some fear or anxiety. I don't know, maybe there's some sin you're carrying with you this morning and you just need to take a moment to confess that before God and just receive His grace anew. But just take a moment within your own heart personally just to pray to God, to talk with Him, to praise Him, to express your need for Him, to express your trust in Him. Let's pray together. God, You are so great. We just want to confess that to You, Lord, that we find You to be great beyond expression. Lord, and we can only capture a glimpse of the greatness of Your power, Lord. And we just acknowledge that You have enough power to meet every need that we bring into this room. You have enough love, Lord, just to forgive every sin that we bring to You in confession. We just thank You, Lord, that You are the God who looked upon us, our brokenness, our sin, and this needy world, and You sent Your Son. And He came, and on that cross, He bore our sin, and He canceled our debt to make a way for us to come to know You, to be in right relationship with You, to enjoy You, and to know that we can live under Your favor, that You are for us and not against us, and that in You we have a hope and we have a future and we have an eternal life that nothing can take from us, that even right now we stand here just eternally secure. And I know, God, in this room, there's people here in a whole bunch of positions, a whole bunch of troubles, a whole bunch of needs and fears and anxieties, Lord, and right now we just cast those at Your feet. We just declare that You are enough. You are powerful enough. You are loving enough. You are great enough, Lord, for us. We trust in You. Help us to trust in You, Father, in all things. Lord, this morning, would You just encourage us and equip us by the power of Your word, which we're going to open together, and we want to open up our hearts to Your word, Lord, and by the power of Your Holy Spirit that lives within us, that moves amongst us, this morning, Lord, would You just encourage and equip us to know You better, to love You more, just to do Your will in this world, to be on mission. God, would You just use us as Your people in Stonewall and in this whole area, just to be Your light, to be Your life to people who so desperately need it. And so, God, just come in this time and we just speak to us. Show us anew the many ways in which You are great. All this we pray in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Go ahead and take your seat, church. And I just want to welcome you here. So glad you're here. I think you are right where you're supposed to be this morning. And if you are here for the very first time, we're just especially glad that you're here. If you are visiting us for the first time, we'd love to thank you for being here after the service. Our welcome center, our round kiosk out in our foyer, there will be someone there who would love to give you a gift to thank you for being with us here today. We're going to release our kids back to their classes, but I want them to know as they go, kids, next Sunday is a special Sunday. Does anybody know what next Sunday is? You're going to be up here next Sunday? I didn't know that. Okay, good. I don't know everything. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, right? So all that to say, kids, if you come here next Sunday, we're going to give you a nice palm, which grows in places that are warmer than Manitoba. And you're going to be able to celebrate Jesus with a palm. So anyway, kids, we'll release you to your classes. As they're going, just want to make you aware of a couple of things. Church coming up in the life of our church. First of all, next Sunday is also a bake sale here at the church. So our youth group has been raising funds to help offset or maybe even fully cover the cost of sending our youth to Youthquake. It's a big youth conference in Briarcrest, end of April. It's just always a really impactful weekend for our youth and their faith. I think this time we have twice as many going as we've ever sent, up to 40. I think approaching 40 youth and some volunteers, which comes with a cost. And I think the cost to cover it all is $8,000. I said, there's no way you're going to raise $8,000. Well, I think we're actually approaching that already. And I think our bake sale might just kind of put us over the top next week. So that's really a huge encouragement to the staff. And I should learn by now not to underestimate God, right? I have this bad habit. And last week we were praying for our youth event, which took place this Friday. And we had Sid Koop, a speaker, come out from Kelowna, and we wanted to organize an Interlake Youth Worship Night. We invited some other churches. We didn't really know if anyone was going to show to join our youth here. We had this guy coming all the way from BC, and Eric, our young, youthful, optimistic youth director, he thought we might have 100 people here, and I said, Eric, let's just temper our expectations a little bit. We had 175 youth and young adults here, and it was just a really awesome Friday. So I know we prayed about that last weekend, and God just did some pretty cool things. It was great there, and just good to see youth from Arbourg and Selkirk and some from the city and other places coming together and being stronger together, and I just get the sense this is maybe the beginning of a movement together of churches in our region to reach our region for Jesus together. So I'm excited about that. All that to say, bring a little bit of extra cash next Sunday because you'll have an opportunity to buy some great baking, which also helps our youth hit that goal to send them to Youthquake. All right, Easter's coming up pretty quick here, 2 weekends time. Just know that on Good Friday, March 29th, we have our Good Friday service here, as we always do, one service, 10 a.m. There'll be childcare, I think up to grade 4 or age 4 in our sunroom. And our choir is going to take a portion of that. They've just got a beautiful kind of presentation for us. We'll be taking the Lord's Supper together. It's going to be a really meaningful time. So I hope that you can join that on Good Friday. And then on Easter Sunday, of course, we've got a regular Easter Sunday services, two services at the same time, 9, 10, 45. This would be a great opportunity if you've got a friend or a neighbor or a coworker or a family member that you'd really love to see come to church. Be a great opportunity to invite them out on Easter Sunday. The last thing I want to mention is that a couple Sundays after that, April 14th, we're having baptisms here in our service. Now, we already have a few people that are working towards that, planning to be baptized on that day. And I just get the sense that there's more people that God's calling to do this. And so if you're someone, maybe you've heard this a few times now, and there's kind of in your own mind, in your own heart, there's that little pull, like, maybe this is something I should do. You haven't done that, but you're a follower of Jesus. But you keep kind of feeling that tug every time you hear that, and there's something that's holding you back. Don't hold back. Don't hold back. If this is a step you need to take or you want to explore, just start with a conversation. Come speak with myself or Pastor Daniel and other ministry staff. We'd love to talk with you about taking this step, which is really a joyful expression of your faith in Jesus. So we're looking forward to those baptisms here on April 14th. So that's all I'm going to highlight. There's much more there in your bulletin that you can take a look at another time. But I want to invite the Walton family to come join me up here. Very often when families in our church, by means of a stork, are delivered another child, I believe that's how it happens. Now the kids have left, we can be real. Many of the families, they like to hear in the family of faith, dedicate their child to the Lord. And this is something that Andrew and Emily Walton here just desire to do, to dedicate their new little girl, Allison. What's the middle name again?
Elizabeth.
Allison Elizabeth. What a beautiful little girl. And congratulations. Thanks. Now, this family here may be new to you. Maybe you've seen them in church, maybe you've not yet met them, but the Waltons are a family that's fairly new to our church, new to our community. We're delighted to have them. God already gave them this tyke over here, Owen, who's got his truck in his hand. Boys are different than girls, I'm told. Have you already found out any differences? Like, is she different than him or at his stage? Is it different raising a girl?
Yeah, it's different.
Is it different?
It's easier so far.
So it could have been harder had I had boys. I can't even imagine. Yeah. Anyway, well, every child is just a wonderful gift from God. And we know that before you were aware that this little one was growing in your womb, before you got that first pregnancy test and you were excited and scared and all those emotions, God already knew all about her. She is God's plan, wonderfully and fearfully made, bearing the image of God. And when I look at a little child, I just think of all the possibilities and potentials that a new little human being holds. Like, what's going to happen in their life? So many questions, so many different paths, right, that their life could take, right? And it's kind of exciting to consider all those possibilities. Like, will she be a teacher in musical theater? Will she be a welder? Or who knows? What will her personality be? Will be she tall or short? Will be she outgoing or shy and reserved? She'll be tall. I think I'm pretty sure she'll be tall. She's already tall. Yeah, all these possibilities and potential. And there's so much that we wonder and will only be revealed in time. But this is what we do know. We know that the purpose for Allison's life ultimately is to know God, to worship God, and to enjoy Him forever. Did you know that's why you exist? Allison, I'm talking to you. Did you know you exist to know God, worship? Say it with me. No. Just. The purpose of her life, as it is for each one of us, is to know God, worship God, and enjoy Him forever. This is what it says in Deuteronomy chapter 6. It says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates," which I think are all ways of just saying families, you know, God and His will and His way is to be the focal point of all of life, of all of life. And we want our children to be happy. We want our children to be healthy. Every parent wants that. But as those who follow Jesus Christ, even more than those things, we want our children to be holy. You chose a verse, I think, kind of in that spirit, a life verse that you've given to Allison, which is on her child's dedication certificate. I think it's Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6, which says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths." And those are verses that you're giving to her today. And what beautiful verses. This is your hope for her, that she will grow to be a woman who trusts in the Lord with all of her heart, and not in her own way, but in His way. And nobody has more influence on the path that she will take than you as mom and dad. You have a high and holy calling as parents. And so it's a bit of a misnomer to call this a child dedication. This is really more a parent dedication, right? Because we can't give her a whole lot of instruction or a charge here. But this is really more for you, mom and dad. Today, Andrew and Emily, that's all right, I'll talk over her. I can do it. Today, you are acknowledging by being up here before your family, your biological family, your spiritual family, you are acknowledging that you have a sacred responsibility to shepherd this child in the ways of God. That your main task is not just to keep them alive or to make sure they get a good education and maybe have a good, happy life with a family of their own. Your main task is to do what you can do to point them to Jesus Christ as the one they need more than anything else. And you do that by preparing her to follow Jesus by the example of your lives. And so the way that you live, the way that you do marriage, the way that you practice faith, the priorities that you have, the way you spend money, the way you talk to one another and about others, all of these things will shape her own beliefs and her own values. And so you're powerful, or your model is a powerful example to her of what faith in Jesus looks like. And listen, but you already have this all figured out, right? Because this is baby number two, old hat, right? You've parented long enough to know that parenting isn't always easy. You need a lot of grace. What I want you to know and all parents to know is our kids don't need perfect parents. They don't need perfect parents. They need parents that are pursuing Christ, which means when we fall short, when we sin, they need to see us coming for the grace of God. They need to see us what repentance looks like, what forgiveness looks like. And that's not a work that you do alone. You do it with the help of God, of His Spirit, of His Word, and you do it with the help of the church. And so church, we have a role in this too. This is kind of a church dedication as well, because we have an important role as a spiritual family to this family, to in the way that we live and conduct ourselves and relate to one another, to display the reality of God and the goodness of the gospel, to create a place where this family and Allison can experience God and His grace. So we all have a role to come alongside, to pray for, to encourage, to maybe help in tangible ways, to babysit. Who knows? Right? No? Yes? No? Maybe? Yeah, maybe. I don't know how far grandparents live from you guys. But church, we also have a role to play in helping raise Allison in the ways of God. And so I just want to put a couple of questions to you first as mom and dad, Andrew and Emily, and then a question to you as a church. First of all, recognizing Andrew and Emily, that God has entrusted Allison to you and that she ultimately belongs to God, do you dedicate her to the Lord for all the purposes that He has for her life? If so, say, we do. And do you commit yourselves as her parents to do whatever you can with the help of God to raise her up to know, love, and serve Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior? If so, say, we do. And then church, recognizing that God has brought the Walton family into this spiritual family, do we commit ourselves to support them as they raise Allison by encouraging them and by pointing them towards the truth and the grace of Jesus Christ in how we live our lives as the body of Christ? If so, let's say together, we do. We do. Okay. Then why don't you stand, church, and just join together as we pray a prayer of dedication over Allison and over this family. And if you feel comfortable, you're welcome just to kind of reach out a hand in their direction. And I won't attempt to try to hold her and do a Lion King or anything like that. That never goes well. Let's pray. Father, we just thank You in Your wisdom that You made Allison. Lord, what a delight it was for You to conceive of her in Your own divine mind and then to place her in this family, Lord. Lord, You have made her full of potential, possibilities, gifts, Lord, personality, a spirit to know You and to enjoy You and to worship You. And so, God, we just pray, Lord, that she would be a girl that would grow to be a woman of faith. Lord, that You would be the guiding force in her life, that You would be the foundation on which she builds her life, that she would be a tool in Your hand, God, to accomplish great things in this world for Your glory. Might Your favor rest on this child. Might You protect her in body, mind, and spirit as she grows. Lord, might You give to Andrew and Emily as her parents just the wisdom and the grace, the strength, the courage, Lord, all that's needed to play this vitally important role. Lord, I can think of no bigger responsibility than to raise up another human being to shepherd them right from infancy. And so, Lord, that's a huge job, and it's not something they can do without Your help and the help of Your people. So, Lord, would You just give them what they're going to need for this journey, just to play their role well? They cannot determine the outcome of her life, Lord, but they can influence and they can shape and they can point her to You in the way they do their life. So, Lord, would You just show them how they can play that role and empower them to do that, Lord? And so as us as a church, Lord, would you just use us in their lives for we pray for years to come, just to come alongside and to model who you are, God, and just to create a safe place, a place of grace where they can grow and where she can grow to discover more and more who you are, the reality of your power, of your love, and your grace. And so, God, we just thank you for the gift that is Allison. And Lord, we just, in dedicating her, we kind of now put her back in your hands and acknowledge that ultimately she is yours, and it's not our plans and desires that we want to see come about, Lord. We want to see your plans and desires for her life become a reality. So that's what we ask for now, in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Kids did great. Yeah, well done. Worship team is going to come back up. And just as you took your seat, I'm going to invite you to stand again. We're going to sing another song of worship. Let's sing. That's right.
Silver moon is softer. Church. I am reading this morning from Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 to 7, and I'm reading from the NIV translation. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die." "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat it from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves.
Well, thank you, Sylvia. And good morning, church. Rusty has joked before that he would give me hard sermon topics. And this time, his intention was to take this one, and then you got like fluid in your lungs or some lame excuse like that. And so I'm the one who gets to do this one this morning. I anticipate that if you were paying attention to the scripture reading, you might have a guess that we're going to be working through a deep and heavy and difficult topic today. Today we're going to be talking about sin, this corrupting force that horribly marred God's good creation. But not just sin as a power and a destructive force, but also our own. The ways in which we are drawn into and ultimately willingly choose to dishonor God in thought, word, and deed. I encourage you this morning, even in the midst of a difficult topic, to be willing to feel the weight of the things we're going to see today. I realize that a hard topic like this can really tempt us just to tune out. I'll wait for something a little more encouraging next week. I'm good. I don't need to feel this today. But I would propose that in order to understand the rest of the Bible, we're in the third chapter, the whole thing, in order to understand everything else that comes after this, we need to understand what happens here. In order to understand the message of the gospel that saves us, we need to look sin in the face and understand what it is and what it does and how it calls us to rebel against God. And so as we do that this morning, we're going to see three things. First, we're going to talk about the nature of sin, and then the draw of sin, and then the battle with sin. And so we'll begin this morning by talking about the nature of sin, what sin actually is. Because we use this word a lot, right? This is a very Christian word. We'll throw it around, I'd be willing to bet, every couple of Sundays, if not every single one. But we rarely stop to actually re-solidify our understanding of what it is. We throw it out, we assume that we all know what we're talking about, and we tend to move on. But we need to be reminded of what sin is at its core. And we have to do this because, like I said, in order to rightly understand the gospel, we need to understand sin. So sin entered the world through the fall in Genesis 3, this story that we just read. And it came through one action, one offense against God that ultimately changed everything. In order to understand exactly what was wrong with Adam and Eve's actions, we first need to understand two trees. I'm going to be reading from Genesis 2:9 and then jumping down to verses 16 and 17. "The Lord God made all kinds of trees grow out of the ground, trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food. In the middle of the garden were the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." And then jumping down to 16. "And the Lord God commanded the man, 'You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die.'" So let's understand this picture here. In Genesis 2, God has placed Adam and Eve, the first man and woman, into a beautiful, delightful garden. He has provided for all of their needs. The provision is there. They have intimate relationship with him. We see in Genesis 3 that they were able to walk with God in the garden, whatever that means. They had beautiful fellowship with him. And in the midst of this garden, there are now two unique trees. There's the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And the second one, tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they were explicitly forbidden to eat from. So between these two trees, the tree of life is much easier to understand. In Genesis 3:22, after the fall, as God is sending them out from the garden, we read, "And the Lord God said, 'The man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever.'" That's what it would have accomplished. This tree granted eternal life. And for a man and woman who have now been corrupted by sin, eternal life is not good news. But John picks up on this idea of the tree of life in the book of Revelation. As we hear about what is coming at the end of time when Christ returns for his people, we read, "Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him." And so this tree that Adam and Eve were ultimately prevented from eating from, the tree of life, is the tree that is offered to those who are in Christ at the end of time. And it is through eating from this tree of life that we obtain eternal life through Jesus. So it's quite straightforward. That one's easy to understand, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is a little bit less so. And so to understand exactly what is being held out with this tree, I think we need to think a little deeply about what has been happening through Genesis 1 and 2. Okay, right, so God is creating everything. And at the end of each day of creation, he identifies something. He says that, or the text says that he saw that it was good. God is exercising his knowledge of good and evil. He sees and he determines that is good, that is good, that is good. But what we also see is that he can identify when something is not good. Adam is created. God is bringing the animals to him and he's naming him. God sees there is not a partner suitable for Adam, and God says that is not good. That will not do. And so God remedies the not good and he makes it good. And so God has shown that he has the knowledge of good and evil, and that ultimately he will provide what is good for Adam and for all of humanity. Adam and Eve don't need to know for themselves what is good and right. They don't need to think about these things. They can trust God's word. When he calls something good, they can trust it as good, and they can stop there. And so the promise of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is the ability for Adam and Eve to be their own moral judges apart from God. And so this tree then is a test. Essentially, it's holding out two questions. With it, God is saying, Adam, do you trust me enough to reject the desire to make these decisions for yourself? Will you simply trust my words about what is good and what is evil? Or will you pursue your own moral autonomy, your own moral reasoning, your own moral decision-making? And I think a secondary question that comes with that, it's about the goodness of God. It's Adam, will you simply have faith that I will give you all that is for your good? Or do you need to be able to make that assessment for yourself? Put simply, that the test is, do you trust me to be a good God? So when Adam and Eve reject God's commands and eat the fruit, it is clear that their answer to these questions is no. They want to be able to decide for themselves. They will not trust God. Rather, they want to be gods themselves. In light of this, I think we see clearly what sin is at its base level. What is the nature of sin? It is rebellion against God. It is a rejection of his commands and his kingly rule, or as the theologian R.C. Sproul put it, it is cosmic treason against the king of the universe. When Adam took the fruit and ate, it was like he was saying, "No, God, I will decide what is good, and I will act on that however I please. As we think about this, we have to remember that God's commands aren't arbitrary, right? They are for our good. The picture we should be getting is not of Adam casting off the chains of a wicked slave master. It's him ignoring the instruction of an all-wise father. What we see, too, is that the tree gave what it promised. We've already read Genesis 3:22, but if we pay attention to the first half, and the Lord God said, the man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. The tree accomplished it. In eating, Adam and Eve became able to judge moral choice. Humanity gained the moral autonomy from God that they wanted. The problem for us is that when God identifies good and evil, when he decides, he's doing it from a position of total wisdom, of total knowledge. He's doing it from a position of boundless grace and goodness. But when we try to decide, we do it as short-sighted, sin-corrupted, self-focused, unwise humans. And we see this all throughout human history. I mean, we've talked in the midst of this sermon series, I believe, about the Spartans, who on the birth of a new child would take the infant, and if they identified anything that seemed like a weakness or a defect, they would leave the baby on the rocks to die. And that was good in their eyes. We think of the Roman Colosseum, the center of entertainment for one of the greatest empires in the history of the world, where slaves and prisoners of war were slaughtered by animals and soldiers for entertainment. And it was good in their eyes. We think of the Crusades, one of the darkest moments in the history of the Christian church, when corrupt religious leaders told people that it was God's will for them to rape and pillage and murder all throughout the Middle East, and they thought that it was good. We see this as we think about slavery, the dehumanization of people brought over into the West to serve as slaves, and they thought it was good. And we see it still in even modern expressions of racism when people look down on people because of their skin color or ethnicity and figure that because of those factors, they are somehow better, and they think that it is good. If human history proves anything, it's that we are terrible moral judges. But we got what we wanted when we ate from that tree. We established our desire to decide good and evil apart from simple trust in God. And we see the consequences of it. So every time we sin, every time that we read God's will in the Bible and choose to do otherwise, it's like we are shaking our fist at God saying, I am king, I am queen, I do as I please, I choose what is good. And the reality is that often in our hearts, we call good what God calls evil, and we call evil what God calls good. The nature of sin then, what it is at its lowest level, it's pride, it's unbelief, and it is rebellion against a good and loving and wise God. So we've established then that the nature of sin, what it was that Adam and Eve were drawn into in Genesis 3. But now we want to see how they were drawn into it. Because in Genesis 3, we see some of the tactics that Satan used to entice them. So first, in verses 1 through 3, we see that he twists God's word. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." Satan lies, but not outright. He picks up on a command that God has given, they should not eat from this tree, but he twists it, he tightens it. He presents it to Eve in such a way to make God sound more strict than he has actually been. He wants to make her doubt the goodness of God. Has God placed you in this garden with all these beautiful trees and said you can't eat from any of them? To go back to what we saw earlier, he's questioning God's ability as a moral judge. Has God really given you what is good? And we see Satan use a similar strategy today, attacking God's commandments by falsely pitting them against his character. Would a loving God really define marriage as between one man and one woman? Would a merciful God really demand that all people come to him through Jesus Christ or not at all? Would a gracious God really take sin seriously? Would he be a God of wrath and justice? The answers to all these questions are yes, but because we are poor moral judges, we can get twisted as Satan seeks to make us misunderstand God's commands. So he erodes trust, and by doing so, he begins the process of enticing Eve into rebellion. I'll be honest in that I don't quite know what to make of Eve's response. Some scholars see her also tightening God's restrictions. She replies, we're not to eat of the tree in the middle of the garden or touch it, or we will die. I think it's possible she might be doing what Satan's doing, kind of making herself more of a legalist. What I think is also possible, and some other scholars propose, is that essentially her and Adam have set up good boundaries. They know that this tree will be a temptation, and so they have for themselves said, we're not even going to touch it. We're not going close to it. We're not taking that risk. Much like someone who knows they're prone to addiction might choose never to drink alcohol, even though their Christian freedom would allow them to do so. So I'm not sure. But what I am sure of, and maybe what is more important, is that Eve never should have had this conversation. And maybe to go even further back, Adam should have taken his role of protector seriously. A serpent never should have been in the garden at all, and the moment that it was there, it should have been driven out. So we have failures on their part to proactively flee from this temptation. Because that's what should have happened. When Satan seeks to tempt us, the worst thing that we can do is to entertain it. Right? To mull over the possibilities, to think about what it would be like to give in, to do what he is calling us to do. And so Eve should have fled, but she didn't. And Adam should have driven the serpent out of the garden, but he didn't. We also see in these verses that more than simply twisting God's word, Satan does outright lie. Verses 4 and 5. You will not certainly die, the serpent said to the woman. For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So in verse 4, Satan directly opposes God. Right? This is now a more extreme form of what he's done in verse 1. Verse 1, he's kind of trying to make Eve infer that maybe God is holding out, maybe he's not being as good as it seems, but now he just goes full assault. What God has said will happen will not happen. God has said you will die, you won't die. He is lying to you. What makes this even more insidious is that he mixes this lie with truth. What he says in verse 5, that this eating of this tree will give them knowledge of good and evil, that's true. It is 100% what will happen. God himself confirms it in Genesis 3:22. But Satan makes his lie seem more credible by putting it in the midst of other truth. Once again, the approach is to make Eve doubt God. Not only did he lie to you about the consequences, but what he's stopping you from pursuing, it would be good. It would be good for you to do. And we feel the pull of these half-truths as well. We know as Christians that sex is a good gift from God. And yet as Satan seeks to use that truth to twist us and to believe lies, he'll convince us that because it's a good gift, we ought to do it whenever we like, with whoever we like, for whatever reason we like. And he lies. We know that food is a good gift from God, but Satan twists this good gift to convince us that because it's good, we should just succumb to the sin of gluttony, eating all that we want. We know that God gives money as a good gift. But as Satan lies and twists it, we begin to believe that we should use the money we've been given to better ourselves, to make our lives easier and more comfortable, rather than generously blessing others. And so with each of these, we feel the temptation to believe that God is holding out on us, that he's given a gift, but he's restricted it in such a way that it's not at its best. We corrupt our understanding, and we prove once again that we are terrible moral judges. And so we see that Satan is more than willing to let us believe truth as long as he can twist that into having us live it out in a lie. He's not always going to go for just full-on deception. Finally, in verses 5 and 6 together, we see that Satan offers a false version of freedom. For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. So we hear the words of the promise that Satan gives. You will be like God. Free from the need to rely on him, free from his rule, you can be the master of your own fate, the captain of your own soul. We humans love this thought of freedom, but we radically misunderstand what true freedom is. I think we can blame this, and probably some other things, on the Americans. Right? As we think about kind of this American dream, what is it? Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That is what life is all about. I am free to do whatever I want without any risk of interference. I do what my heart feels. I do what it tells me. I go. But this is not freedom. When we pursue that American version of freedom, what we are actually pursuing is slavery to our own desires and to our own passions. We enslave ourselves to the basic desires of our bodies or the fallen desires of our minds, right? Whatever I feel like doing, I will do. But what if, just maybe, your desires are wrong? What if they are destructive? Or, what I think is likely true for many of us, they maybe aren't immediately obvious as destructive, but they just simply aren't what would be best for you. What if your heart is wrong? That's why the Bible is clear that apart from Christ, we are enslaved to sin. What feels like freedom from God's oppressive rules is actually just enslavement to a wicked slave master. One who wants us to be destroyed, to die. And so we see that true freedom is not freedom from boundaries, but rather it is living within the boundaries set by a good and wise and loving God. When I was growing up, my brother really enjoyed having fish. I don't know why, that just seemed like a lot of work for a really stupid animal. But I remember, I think we came home from school one day, and we ran up into my brother's room, and the fish wasn't in its tank. And, you know, we figured maybe that the cat had gotten inside and grabbed it. We grew up on a farm. Animals dying was normal. That was fine. But then the weekend came, and we were cleaning up our rooms, and my brother moved his dresser, and there's a dead fish laying behind the dresser on the floor. Now look, I don't think fish are capable of this level of intelligent thought, but just suspend disbelief and go with me for a minute here. I think we can imagine the stupid little fish seeing the glass walls of its tank and going, this is oppressive. It's restrictive. I'm not free. I need something more. And swimming to the bottom and trying to shoot itself out the top and thinking that it had acquired freedom until the moment that it broke the surface of the water. And then it realized why the boundaries were there. Without them, it would die. Unfortunately, we are all too often as short-sighted as the fish. The promise of this seeming freedom draws us to jump outside the tank, thinking that if we just free ourselves from the oppressive standards that God has given us, that my life will be more joyful, more fulfilling, it will be better than it could ever be. But living outside the commands of God never results in freedom. It results in death. And so Satan entices Eve to sin by offering her the prospect of God-like freedom. And what's scary, and what we see ultimately leads to the fall, is that she entertains it. Remember, we noted earlier that throughout Genesis 1 and 2, the one person through those narratives who decides what is good is God. At the end of each day, God saw that it was good over and over and over. And we come to Genesis 3, and Eve looks at the fruit, and in her mind, she decides that is good. It was never a decision that she should have been making. God had already told her it was bad. It was not for her good, but already she's trying to exercise this freedom from God's moral standards. So she looks, she identifies something as good that God has called bad. And as the story continues, she takes and eats. She gives the fruit to her husband who was with her, and he eats. And creation is plunged into the brokenness of sin in such a way that as we now live, our natures have been utterly corrupted by it. That we are born as those enslaved to this wicked power. With that fall, that'll be what Rusty picks up next week. But there's one last thing that we need to look at this morning, and that is the battle with sin. I'll lay my cards on the table a little bit here. My prayer at this point is that a lot of us would be feeling the weight of sin right now. I really hope that we are all feeling conviction about the seriousness of our sin and frankly, the lack of seriousness with which most of us take it in our day-to-day lives. And I truly believe that the conviction that the Holy Spirit brings in the lives of believers when we're reminded of how serious and awful sin is a good thing. It's a good thing to feel. And so as I encouraged you at the start, I encourage you again now, sit with this. Don't run from the hard. Feel the weight of your sin. Feel the ways in which it dishonors God. And let that fuel you in your battle against sin. And yes, I used the word battle intentionally. We need to realize that sin is a powerful adversary. And if we take it lightly in our lives, it will destroy us. Like, hear me. If you've zoned out to this point, listen to me now, because these might be, for some of you who do not know Christ yet, the most important words you will ever hear. Any sin in your life, no matter how small you may think it is, if left unchecked, will destroy you. It will. Or if you're a believer today, and you think you can get away with just one little thing here, and God doesn't really expect me to work that out. My pride, he's fine with it. My prayerlessness, my grumbling and complaining, my lashing out in anger, my gossiping, selfishness, my sexual sin, my greed, my unwholesome speech, how I dishonor my parents, how I'm bitter, how I'm envious, how I lie all the time. God, he'll be okay with it. Not only do these sins do harm to those around you, but far more importantly, they dishonor God. He is displeased with us when we sin. And like Adam and Eve, with each one, we are making the conscious decision of rebellion against him. But as we think about this today, this is where the good news comes in, I promise. As we think about this today, as we think about fighting this battle, we need to realize that if we don't fight it from the right hill, we are doomed to failure. Let's think about Adam and Eve again. Right, newly created in an unfallen world, God has supplied them with everything they need in this beautiful garden. He walks in fellowship with them in the garden. It's intimate fellowship. They know God. Their natures have not yet been corrupted by sin like ours have been, and yet when temptation came, they utterly failed. And so I ask you this morning, if Adam and Eve, with all of the advantages they had, could not stand up against temptation, what hope do you have? If you leave here today feeling conviction and you go home and try to fight this battle by your own strength, good luck. It's not going to go well. Now, don't get me wrong. You may succeed for a day or a week or a month or maybe even a year, but at some point your own strength will fail. Or you might have a little bit of victory over this one sin that's bugging you, but another will rise up and take its place. Fighting the battle against sin from the hill of your own strength is a losing battle. But for those of us who are in Christ, we get the privilege of fighting from a different hill. By repentance and faith in him, we no longer need to battle by our own strength. We battle by his. We think of Jesus, who the New Testament calls the last Adam. tempted to sin in the Garden of Gethsemane. That is not by mistake. Jesus is tempted to choose what his human nature desired rather than following through with God's will. He's fearing death, sweating drops of blood in intense anxiety. But where the first Adam in his garden took the fruit and ate and plunged the world into sin, the last Adam instead resolved, "Not my will, but yours be done." And he went to the cross where he achieved utter victory over sin. Brothers and sisters, Jesus' death did not just pay the penalty for your sin, it also guaranteed your victory in the battle against it. Ephesians 1, 3, and 4 say, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight." The same death of Christ that purchased your salvation purchased your sanctification. You are made holy not by your own strength, but because the Lord Jesus bought your holiness on the cross. At the cross, Jesus won the war. It was over. Satan, sin, and death were defeated. And our existence now, in light of that, is much like the end of World War II. And let me explain that. On June 6th of 1944, the Allied forces stormed the beaches of Normandy. And having won victory on D-Day, many historians agree that with that battle, the war was essentially won. It was over. The foothold in Europe was enough that Hitler was going to fail. But it was still 11 months from the victory in D-Day until VE Day, Victory in Europe Day, when Germany finally surrendered. So even though the war had been won, essentially, in 1944, there were still many bloody battles fought on the way to May of 1945. And so we live now in the time between D-Day and V-Day. Christ has already decisively won the war. But as we wait for the final defeat of Satan and sin, we still have some bloody battles to fight in our battle against their power in our lives. But in Christ, we fight from a better hill. We no longer fight from the hill of our own strength and willpower, but we fight from the hill of gospel promises. We fight from a winning position. And so when Satan and his demons seek to entice us into sin, we can respond, "Satan, you have been defeated. You have no power." When our own flesh tempts us to sin, this innate corruption in us draws us in, we can respond like the Apostle Paul did, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who lives, but Christ who lives in me. This life I now live in the flesh. I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Therefore, I will not dishonor my Lord with my body." When the world tempts us to sin, when it seeks to make promises that seem sweeter than what God has promised, we can respond, "Whatever you're offering, Christ has promised better." As we think about this and the battle with particular sins, I think of the fact that when I'm tempted to remain angry and seek revenge, I trust the gospel promise of Romans 12, 19. "Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, 'It is mine to avenge, I will repay,' says the Lord." When I'm tempted to just rest in my pride and remain conceited and puffed up, thinking I'm better than others, I'm reminded of the promise of Christ from Matthew 5, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." When I'm tempted to worry and doubt that God will provide, I trust the promise of Matthew 6, 33, where Jesus, after speaking of the provision that God gives for birds and for flowers, he says, "But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things, all of the provision you need, will be given to you as well." When I feel the pull of any sin that tries to convince me that I will find more satisfaction or more joy or more pleasure in it than in the Lord, I'm reminded of the promise of Psalm 16:11. "You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures in your right hand." We battle the false promises of sin with the real promises of God to us in Christ. And so, church, as we see the first sin of humanity, feel the weight of that today. Sin is wicked. It is heinous. Every sin that we commit is wretched rebellion against God. It might mean today that there are things you have to go before the Lord in confession. Things that you must give up that you have been holding on to honor him with your life. The things that maybe you find the most pleasure in are things that he has called you away from. You must turn from your sin to find satisfaction in Christ. Jesus himself said, no man can serve two masters. It's never going to be an either or it's always going to be an either or. It's never going to be a both. And turn from your sin, feel the weight, feel the conviction, and flee to the Lord because he is faithful and just to forgive. The penalty has been paid by Christ. All you must do is turn from it, and the Lord delights in forgiving. As we see how Satan enticed Adam and Eve, let's be aware of his schemes. He is going to lie to you. He's going to tell you false truths. He's going to pick on the things in your personality, the things that you love, that he knows he can use to twist you away from God. He will take delight in trying to ruin you in that way. He is going to try to make you question God's character, but he has been defeated. Anything he promises you will fall apart. Call him on it. Confront his lies with the truth of Scripture, and he will flee. And let us see that in our battle against sin, our own strength is not going to bring us any victory. Stop trying. Your own power will not defeat the sin in your life. You must rely on the goodness and grace of the Lord Jesus and the power of the Spirit who he has given you. Romans 8:13 says that if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the flesh, you will live. None of the writers in the Bible thought we had any power to do it by ourselves. By the power of God's Spirit, as we trust God's promises in his word to battle against the sins that we must shake, it'll be a fight. It will be. For some of you, it can be weeks or months or years or decades battling the same sin, but we must make war against the sin in our life because Christ has already won the victory. And so we fight now from his position of victory. And so, church, let us rely on that victory. The battle has already been won. Even as we go from here today into our week and we face the struggle against sin in our daily lives, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. The victory is assured, but he calls us to fight. And let us do that by his power, by his word, and by the Spirit who he has given us. Let's pray. And so, Father, as we have felt the weight this morning of our rebellion, our daily decision to do the things that you hate, the things that dishonor you. Father, we come before you this morning as your people, and we beg your mercy once again. Lord, as we think about these sins that entangle us and that draw us down, we repent of those today. We do not want to dishonor you with our lives. We want everything we do to be for your glory. And so we thank you that there is mercy and forgiveness in the Lord Jesus Christ. That in our daily battle, that you are a God of forgiveness. And so, Lord, as we turn from our sin, we ask that you would give us the strength to fight this battle, that you would remind us daily of the power that you have given us in your Spirit, that this victory has already been won, that sin's power has been defeated, that its days are numbered. And so as it scratches and claws and fights in the midst of this time, that it's doing it out of desperation, that it has no hope of ultimate victory. So, Lord, empower us as we go from here to honor you with our lives. Lord, I pray especially for those this morning who are feeling that weight. Father, your Spirit might be convicting them of sin for the first time, and they're feeling this draw to finally give up the battle and to run to Christ. Father, we thank you that you are doing that work in them. Bring it to completion, Lord. Let them see the beauty of Christ and find forgiveness and freedom in him. But we pray, Lord, that with each moment we live, that we would be a people intent on making war against that which is dishonoring to you, that we would seek to glorify you in all that we do, but that when we have those victories, we would know that it is not by our strength, that it is not by our might, but it is because our help is in the name of the Lord. Amen.
Everyone like to stand and sing along.
Daniel, I think you were supposed to preach that sermon, so thank you. I think we've been left with lots to think about, and I don't know, maybe God has been speaking to you in some way through something you've heard here, and which might cause you to feel like you need to talk with somebody right now, or maybe you just feel like you need prayer. Whether it's something you just heard here this morning or something you just brought in with you, and If that's true in your case, we have a prayer team available in our fireside room. If you go to your right, you'll see a prayer banner. Go there. There's people that would love to talk with you and to pray with you. I want to send us out with this blessing we find in the little book of Jude, which says this: to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, both now and forevermore. And together we say, amen. Amen. Go in his love.